My guest this week is Jo Koy, best known for me fucking him at the Comedy Store 20 years ago.
Yeah, he did. He fucked me pretty hard, man.
And when I did your podcast, The Koy Pond,
yeah,
and you brought it up, and then I replayed that night in my life. But we could talk about it real quick. There was a night where, you want to do your version?
Well, you mean the right version? What are you talking about? That's the stupidest question.
No.
Do you want me to tell the jury my side? Yeah, I'd love to. Not guilty, Your Honor. I'll tell them what you did, you fucking asshole. Okay. I had a writer come to see me.
Right? I didn't know that.
Yeah, they came to see me.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, you're a real dick. By the way, this wasn't 20 years ago. Oh, wait, it was 20 years ago.
Like 2000.
Yeah, you're right. It was 2000.
2021.
It was.
Yeah.
Holy shit.
You didn't have a kid?
We're old. No, we're not.
I didn't have kids?
Fuck, it has been 21.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Thank you so much.
Coming in hot. Oh, we don't play here. Get some. Yeah.
I love it, man.
What's the pay? Nothing.
So this is what happened. I had this writer come to write about me being like up and coming, half white, half Asian guy trying to make it in this business. And I asked Gary if I could get on. Well, I didn't ask you.
You were on the show.
I was on the show.
I was hosting.
It was your show, though.
It was Fat Tuesday, but I was hosted. I didn't book it.
But didn't
it.
You take it over?
Yeah, we were, me and my wife, we took it over behind the scenes.
Yeah.
But
so I knew that much. I knew Guy already stepped away.
Yeah.
And I had the relationship with Guy. I had a relationship with you, but it was more on the road.
Yeah.
Right?
Kind of? Yeah, we did a couple colleges together.
Yeah, colleges and BET. Yeah. So anyways, I thought we were fucking friends.
We are friends.
I thought we were close friends. So I'm like, oh, this is going to be a good situation. Gary's hosting. I got this guy that's going to write a cover on me, which means I get the fucking cover of this magazine. You don't know what a cover page is. So we sit down. I had the best spot, man. I think I was two.
Yeah.
I had like the best spot. It's like you, another guy, and then me. It was like perfect for this write-up.
You were.
In comes George Wilburn.
Yeah.
If you guys don't know George, he's a beast. He's an animal.
Yeah.
Right?
Especially 21 years ago.
Especially 21 years ago when shiny shoots were the shit. Right? Yeah. When shiny shoots were the shit, George had
never,
all of them.
Never trust a comic with a shiny suit.
Shiny suit. Shiny suit and colors you've never heard of. Lavender.
Fuchsia. Apricot.
Fuchsia. Bright teal. Like whatever the fuck that is, right? Salmon. So anyways, he came in and he's like, hey, Gary, I'm just going to go up real quick. And then you were like, for sure.
I didn't.
For sure go up, George. And I'm like, Gary, man, I just got these people that are going to.
I don't remember this conversation.
Oh, you're so full of shit, dude.
I don't remember you telling me you had people there.
Yes, you do. I go, Gary, I got these guys. Like, they're here. They're going to write about me. And they're like, yeah. But he's just going to do a quick five. A quick five. Right. I promise you. And you guys start laughing. You start high-fiving them, hugging. Almost like you're like, it was almost like you indirectly told George, let this motherfucker burn.
I would never do that to people.
Gary, that's exactly what you did.
Not on purpose.
But I felt it. You know how you just feel the energy?
Yeah.
Like you feel like whatever situation's happening right here, I'm not involved and I know what they're doing. Mm. It's to destroy me and my career. Which camera's mine? Which one's mine? They're all red.
They're all on, Joe. They're all yours.
Which one's mine? Is it the red one?
I usually have one camera, but I felt bad, so I brought four in for you.
Thank you.
To
so
make
much.
Up for you. 21 years ago.
21 years ago, asshole. So this is what happens. George goes up.
He went way long.
Not only did he go way long, he went at it with some chick in the audience.
Oh, that's right.
He went at it with this chick in the audience. They went back and forth. George won every single thing that they said back and forth. George won. Standing ovation. Gary, the MC that he is, doesn't even bring the crowd back down as an MC. He literally just goes up and goes, all right, you guys, man, you ready? Jo Koy.
I did.
You
what
did
I
absolutely
hate people
nothing.
Doing.
You didn't do anything after George. I'm talking George fucking destroyed. I can't explain it, but it looked like a like when the like the first season of Def Comedy Jam. You know what I mean?
The crowd was like
the crowd was just standing.
Oh, Joe. Well, I want to
finish the story.
Okay, I'm sorry about that.
So then I go up and totally eat my dick. I think I pull my dick out and physically eat it. Right? Because that's all you can do in that situation. And then I get off stage, and you know what the writer says to me? With the photographer and the editor, they all came, all three of them, right? They go, hey, you know, we'll just come and see you another time. And as I look over my shoulder, I see Gary and George like, well, in my head, that's what I envisioned. But you guys were like, yes.
I'm not a spiteful comic.
And no, not at all.
I'll tell you what I did to you. I did what's been done to me, and I still hold grudges against people that have done that to me in the past.
Really?
That go long. I don't hold it like I hate you for the rest of your life, but yeah. I take a mental note.
Oh, yeah.
So I'll be honest with you. Looking back on it, I don't remember the photographer and the writer part of it.
Are you sorry?
I'm very sorry. Especially knowing the kind of person you are now, I felt awful. And you looked so defeated.
I was defeated.
You looked at me and you go, who was that?
I said, what was that?
Yeah, comics do this. When they, quote unquote, eat it.
Yeah.
You come up with every rationale in your brain why you ate it. Yeah. It could be the mic was left-handed. Yeah. I'm a right-handed comic.
Yeah.
Or you come up with all these excuses. You literally just went, who was that?
Yeah.
Why'd you put me after George?
I knew it too. I fucking knew it, man. I've seen George destroy.
I apologize.
Oh, that's
21
very
years
nice.
Later, I'm so sorry. But that's why.
But you know what really killed me? Which one's my camera? You know what really killed me, Gary? Is the fact that I even said, Gary, I only need to do 5 minutes.
I'm sorry.
I only need to do five for this writer. As I cried a little.
Well, if it makes
my God, I got one more thing for you. This is going to make you feel real shitty.
That I did to you?
No, it's from the same night.
Okay. I was like, dude.
Bro, I didn't live in LA. I drove to LA from Vegas, and I had to drive back.
That was a long drive back.
You son of a bitch. But you know what? You took me to a nice steak dinner like 7 years later.
In Cincinnati. Yeah, we did pick you up.
Yeah.
You're the only, when you came to Cincy, I think there's been three comics that I made a trip down to the Funny Bone to see because I like them either as people or I like their stand-up. You, Kevin Hart came. I came down to hung out with him. And Mitch Hedberg, I came just to see. And he died a week later.
No.
The week before he died, I said, I didn't even know him. I just wanted to see his act because I was like, to me, he was one of those comics that I was like, how does he make this shit so simple?
Yeah.
And I don't think
crazy.
Of that.
Yeah. You know what's nuts? I'm glad you said that because there's comics that I wish I would have seen and I kept pushing it back. Mm-hmm. It was Don Rickles. Because my manager was his manager, and he kept saying, I can bring you down. And I was like, you know, I was on the road, and, you know, when I got home, I was tired, and I always had an excuse, and then never got a chance to see him. Yeah. Mitch was another one. Mm-hmm. Mitch, I think he was at the, Cobbs or something, and the manager was like, hey, Mitch is here. And I was like, oh, I'll see him next time. And then he passed. I was like, that's it.
Yeah.
So I guess what I'm trying to say is, do it. If you want to do something, fucking do it because you're going to miss out, man.
Comics die.
Just whatever it is that you want to, you know, we procrastinate too much. And those two things right there, like really inside, like really like I've always held because I got Don's book. Like I always wanted to hug Don. You know what I mean? Yeah. I just wanted to like hug him and say thank you. Like.
Did you hear the Frank Sinatra story about Don Rickles?
Oh, I love that story. I love everything about that man. You know, my there was this thing called Comic Relief back in the day. It was Whoopi, Billy, and Robin. And when you're broke back in the 80s, you know, you looked forward to that event because it was every comic, you know what I mean, raising money. So you got to see everybody. I swear to God, Don Rickles, I think still to this day has the best set from that. From Comic Relief. If you can watch it. And it was all freestyle, off the top of his head.
Old dude
in a tux, just fucking killing it.
Did you see him, like, basically roast Reagan?
No.
Ronald Reagan?
Nuh-uh.
Yeah, they did, like, you get elected in office, and you do the big celebration. Not the correspondence dinner. This is like a big celebration. And to me, there's certain gigs that are hell gigs.
Yeah.
I would think
the correspondent.
For, Hell Gig.
Yeah.
That thing that Don Rickles was doing, I go, to me, that's like a Hell Gig. To me, the MTV Music Awards, Hell Gig.
Oh, Hell Gig.
Because you got young kids just yelling.
Oh, that don't give a fuck. There's a pit. There's a pit.
Right. Every time I see them, yeah. Like this. Or the anything that has to do with music, American Music Awards. Yeah. I saw Cedric one time, yeah. American Music Awards, and I go, this is a Hell Gig for him.
Yeah.
He, you know, Cedric's so smooth, he's not going to let you know he's flustered. No. But I was like, they're not listening.
No, no one is.
They're like, come on, man.
Uh-uh. And you know what? They don't care about what you're wearing, what topics you're talking about. It's just who's coming out. That's it.
Or you,
just tell us who the next performer is.
Then when you bag on somebody, the camera goes to them. And yeah, they just go, oh, and they're not laughing.
No one's laughing.
I'm like,
that's so true.
It's a Hell Gig.
That is the worst reaction. Anyone that does an award show and you roast people in the audience, yeah. ESPYs.
ESPYs wouldn't be as bad.
Ah, ESPYs is bad.
To me, I would love to do the ESPYs. You know what I mean?
Well, you got relationships with those guys.
Yeah.
But anyone else?
I would love
to. I don't know. When ESPY. I watch it, I always, Jamie crushes it. But Jamie crushes his performances.
Yeah.
But I feel like, you know, when they cut to the audience, they're always just, their ego is so big because they're athletes.
Yeah. Speaking of athletes, who you got this weekend?
Tom Brady.
Really?
Yeah, man.
You want to put dinner on it?
Yeah.
I'll take the Chiefs.
Are we you want to do it?
Let's do a fist bump. It's COVID.
All right, yeah. Let's do it.
I'll take the Chiefs.
Mm-hmm. I like Brady. I love Brady.
I wouldn't be mad at the
Buccaneers.
I think
the three interceptions on the last game was just for show. I think it was to pull the odds up.
Mm. I wouldn't be mad if Brady won, but I think Mahomes is that dude.
Dude, he is that dude. You ever see slow-mo of just like some awkward throw that he does?
Mm-hmm. The good thing is,
there was this camera angle where he throws.
Oh, yeah.
He just kind of, and it's just, I don't know, man. That shit you can't teach.
And you know what's cool? He's got the same hair as mine and your son.
Yeah, it's so funny.
Your son should be shaving the sides.
Yes.
Right now.
My son should have cornrows. My son should have anything that can prevent him from getting, and when I say this, I'm not trying to be mean, but dreadlocks. But not the dreadlocks that you're trying to grow.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, there's people that grow them nicely.
Yeah.
Then there's my son, where it's just happening. You know what I mean? Because it's lack of care.
If he does not shower for three days.
3 days not showering, sleeping on the same side of his
head.
Where
does the hair come from like that?
You know what?
His mom's white, right?
No, his mom's Filipino, but we figured it out, right? There is an aboriginal. There is an aboriginal. That Filipinos that were aboriginal, right? Mm-hmm. Which look like they're black people.
Hold on. I see you like I know. Yeah. Yeah, of course. There's Filipinos that are aboriginal. Yes, Joe. But, I knew that.
what we're saying is there's got to be an aboriginal bloodline because he's dark complected. His grandma's dark, thick hair, curly. My son has an afro. And then we looked it up on Google. We Googled it. And there's a picture. You know when you Google whatever we Google it, there's a picture of whatever you're looking at. Mm-hmm. It's my fucking son from like 1940. You know what I mean? It's the same fucking hair.
Have you done ancestry.com?
Same underwear. It's like, that's you on Monday. That's you on Zoom class. Swear, dude.
Do you do ancestral.com?
Yeah, we did it. Yeah, we did it. You know what's funny is he told his teacher he was black, half black. That's how dumb the teacher is. She goes, every kid was supposed to learn something during the Christmas break. I think this is 3 years ago. And they go, Joe, what did you learn? And he goes, oh, I learned that I'm half black. Like, you don't learn that you're half black when your parents are both Filipino. But the dumb teacher was like, oh, that's awesome. But not in no, like, oh, your mom cheated?
Yeah.
What the fuck are you talking about? Like,
my name is actually Jerome Koy.
Yeah. I'm black. I'm half black. So he never told her. Never told her. It was the funniest shit. So that's a very true story. I know there's a teacher watching, but 100%, my son and his friends sold that shit to her, and the whole, for the rest of the year, thought my son was half black.
Did I, like, by History Month, they was like, hey, Joe.
Hey, Joe, you know
Happy
what?
Happy Black History Month.
Don't come to class. This is your day.
I'll tell you what was crazy. I was at the doctor's office about a year ago, before COVID. Definitely before COVID. And you were doing the Chase Center in San Francisco like in February last year, right?
Yeah, that was crazy. And two of them, bro. Two
shows at the Chase Center.
Yeah.
Yeah. I go to get my blood drawn. The lady's Filipino taking my blood.
Oh, shit.
So she goes, what do you do? And I was like, my Filipino accent is terrible.
Yeah, that was awful.
Just all peas.
Yeah.
But do you poo?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
She's taking my blood. And I went, well, I'm a comedian. She goes, oh, do you know? I go, Jo Koy. She goes, yes! And literally, she's drawing my blood. And I'm getting all the blood work. So it's not like one. I'm there for 15 minutes. And she, for 15 minutes, talked about how they're going to see you. Her daughter got her tickets. You're the guy. And I'm sitting here going, you know what this is like, right? I told her, this is like you're taking blood from Steph Curry and you're telling him how good LeBron is. I get it. No. I'm sure you're good too. But Joe.
Oh, shit. She didn't say that.
No.
Did she?
No. Oh, man. But it was like, but she I could not she remember your name, and her daughter's one that got tickets. Like, yeah. It was going to be a family event.
Yeah.
And she just was going nuts. And I was just, I called it. Jo Koy.
Can I tell you something about Filipinos, man? That whole, I think it's an act.
Oh, really?
I think they do that on purpose. The my mom does that shit. So I don't know what it is. She knew it was Jo Koy the whole time. Because my mom will do that with the kids in the fucking house. Mom, Joe. Joseph, come here.
Hey,
she'll
do that. The beer commercial with your mom.
Oh, jeez.
You really got, was that real emotions?
Oh, look who it is.
Was that real emotions? What's
yes.
up?
Yes,
it was. You want to just walk in? Everybody's going, who's there?
Hello, Brendan.
What's up, guys?
Hello, handsome.
Just off camera. Did we get another mic?
Oh, I love you, man. Love you more. Yes.
What's up, brother?
I'm good.
I know I'm here.
Look at that. Don't. It's just a show. It's just a show.
What
watch you got on? This is a game we play every day.
Wow, you smell amazing, Brendan.
What do you got?
You're gonna shit, man.
You got a new one? The Daytona, the white.
Yeah, baby.
Guess I'll.
That's arena money, man.
What's that?
Yeah, man, that's cool. Yeah, it's cool. That's
real,
fun.
Real motherfucker. Okay, yeah, real
it
diamonds.
Is it
beautiful?
I wouldn't wear fake diamonds. Not. So past that stage, I ain't featuring, homie.
My MC out there, don't get his Rolex wet, man.
Yeah, oh, really?
That's so true. Yeah, I
that's
love it.
Real deal.
I love that Brendan just walks in.
Right. Just fucking slow walks in. Though.
Yeah.
And by the way, he's never like Brendan's never walked in when I had a black guest. Ever.
Oh, that's offensive. What is that? Yeah. Nope. Let's not air this at all.
Nah.
That's not airing
never,
any of that.
Joe, I said, wow, I think I've had, I think you're my third non-black guest.
Yeah.
And I was like, I said, wow, I'm starting to cross over.
Yeah.
And
then that's nice.
Brendan shows up.
Of course. Well,
I
love Brendan.
You gotta get Brendan on. Where'd you meet Brendan Schwab since he's here?
When I first met him,
mm-hmm.
I met him. Actually, we met via DM to do the show.
That's right.
And then
talking shit about you? Say you're difficult to work with?
Never.
Oh,
me?
Yeah. That was.
Yeah.
That's how I got on Fighter and the Kid.
Oh, is that how it happened? Oh, Jesus Christ. Is that how it happened?
I said, yo, I DM'd both him and Count. I go, yo, who said I'm difficult to work with?
Oh, shit.
It was, it was.
You should have called me in for a guest while you were on, because that would have confirmed.
Yeah. Oh, I fucked him 20 years ago.
Oh, fuck. Oh, yeah, bad, dude. At the store.
I had to apologize.
Fat Tuesdays.
I set him up for failure. He got
no,
bumped for
yeah,
another
he bumped
comic.
Me, but he put an old...
Looking back, it was a dick move. I shouldn't have did it.
Yeah. George Wilbur, look him up. Old school black comic, just beast
shiny
on
suit.
Stage.
Yeah. It was Fat Tuesdays. It was Black Knight. And I didn't know Joe had like a photographer,
there.
Editor doing
I had
a piece
writers
on
there
him.
For a magazine.
Totally fucked his whole career.
Yeah. Fucked
you know
me.
What I mean?
Send me back another 10 years.
I guarantee you, if he now that he's doing like 14 shows in Phoenix, he would be doing 18 if that didn't happen.
You're going to hate me when I say this, but I did do 18.
Well, you would have done
20. Which one's my camera?
He would have done 20.
Which one's my camera? Brendan, they're all on, by the way. Which one's mine?
Oh, you did 18? But it's half capacity.
You know, every time I say which one's my camera, they all point at this one. Like I forgot.
18. No. It was half capacity. That's not half capacity. That's nine shows.
You know what's crazy is that room doesn't look half capacity. Have you played it yet? At all. So yeah. whatever Joe is doing, God bless you, man.
You did stand up live?
Yeah, I did stand up live.
Yeah, it does not. Well, what's it hold? 500?
600 when they pack them.
How many did you have?
Let's just say I got this the other day.
What'd you get with it? What? I bought a Rolls Royce and a watch.
I don't know what to do.
You know who did that?
Yeah.
And I got him on in a couple weeks. Michael Blackson did a fucking hellacious run at Houston Improv. Like the stars aligned.
Yeah.
And he added Monday and just like, almost like you in Hawaii, just a lesser version. Mm-hmm. But all of a sudden he did Houston. So, you know, like you're doing the math in your head, ticket prices, percentage of the doors. So you, as a comic, you kind of know what they're walking out with.
Yeah.
So I'm sitting there going, he kept saying, add another show. The week after Houston, he had a Rolls Royce. I went, did you take the check and get a Rolls Royce from the Houston Improv? Which is kind of G shit. Like, 1 week of work, you got a Rolls Royce.
Oh, shit.
Literally the week after. I can't wait to ask him when he comes on.
Oh, shit. That's
like,
so
he did Houston,
funny.
Added all these shows, and then next week, I see the little stars.
Yeah, yeah.
And on the roof of the car, and I'm going, did that fucker go buy a Rolls Royce afterwards?
That's so like, my favorite Michael Blackson is him going to the airport, baggage claim, customer service department to get his Versace bag with the broken wheel. Yeah. That, to me, that is the funny. I'm like, hey, asshole, did you put a Versace bag underneath American Airlines? I wish all the fucking wheels were broke, you dick. Who does that? If I'm working at American Airlines during a pandemic, I'm kicking the shit out of that fucking bag. I'm gonna piss on it. I'm gonna break both wheels. Dick move.
How did you see that? I missed that.
It was how can you not watch Michael Blackson? It's like
there's a lot. There's a lot going on.
I have to watch it.
If it's not a girl twerking her ass, I skip over it.
I can watch him. This guy has no filter. We've known him for so long.
Yeah, he's been doing stand longer than us.
I was on the Black College Comedy Tour. I was other.
With
by
you.
The way.
Did you get ripped off?
By the way, I don't think people know that. Yeah, of course, yeah. I was ripped off.
Me too.
I don't think anyone knows this, but Gary and I were on this thing called the Black College Comedy Tour. That's literally what it was called. And on the applications, well, not the application, but the contract that he would fax us.
Yeah.
It would say Black College Comedy Tour, and then he would use clip art that you get from Microsoft Word,
yeah.
And it was the black court gesture.
Yeah, yeah.
That was his logo. Yeah. And then he made t-shirts out of it. And then
he would hope. Let me tell you what happened with this guy.
Oh, God, you tell him. Don't say his name, Gary.
No, I'm not. We met at University of Alabama.
Because
I remember I got in the van, and he was like, hey, I'm Jo Koy. I go, what's up, man? I'm going to fuck you in a year from now.
Yeah.
Good meeting you, man. Get ready for this ride.
Yeah. Wait, who was Alabama?
Lavelle was on that show. Crawford, me, you, and the promoter hosted. And that I found out the reason is because he got the check.
He got the check for that.
So this is how I found out he was ripping me off.
How?
He always was adamant about getting the check, and
bro,
he paid you from his company.
Yep.
I was at Louisiana Lafayette.
Dude.
He missed his flight.
Yep.
He goes, Gary, they're going to give you the check. Just put it in a FedEx envelope, send it to me, and I'm going to wire the money into your account. And I go, why is he so adamant about that? So it's illegal to open mail. So I'm doing everything, the light.
Yeah.
I think I steamed water. I go, oh, it popped open. I saw it. It was $15,000 for the university, $3,500.
Yep. Oh,
I went like this. This guy, wait a minute. He's walking away with like $12,000.
Yep.
And I'm getting three. And I was the only one on the show. He didn't show up.
Yeah.
That's how I went.
Exactly. You were getting the headliner money. I was the feature. So I was getting $12.50 a show, right?
He was
I found out, I was opening for, I think I was opening for some more in Houston. And he didn't show up. Same shit, right? And he goes, Joe, I need you to pick up the check. They're going to have it in a FedEx envelope. Same thing, right?
Same thing.
He goes, just put it in the mail and I'll make sure. I'm already putting your check in the mail now. You'll get it right when you get home. I promise you, which was $12.50. By the way, that's all inclusive. That was plane ticket, food, and hotel. So you'd go home with like $400 maybe. Yeah. And then I'm like, all right, cool. But I always hated him. He was such a dick to me, right? Mm-hmm. But here's the thing, you guys. This is why you need to be nice if you're going to do foul shit. Because he was a dick to the kids that booked the show. So they already hated him. Mm. So they kind of like handed me this open envelope and kind of gave me that look. Yeah.
Winked?
Yeah, man. They're like, hey, here's that check you're supposed to give, blah, blah, blah. Like, go ahead and look at it. They left it open and everything. And I looked at that shit. I was like, this motherfucker, man. I think it was like 20, I think it was like 25,000 bucks.
But he did that because I was starting to wonder, the light comes on after a while when all the contracts are the same.
Yeah.
Like my money for the whole year was 3,500.
Yep. Mine every was time I was like this.
So wait a minute. ITT Tech is the same as LSU.
Yep.
The budget has to be different.
Yeah.
And then when we did LSU, got me. The flyer had like four comics. It was me and him when we got there. And I was like, they said the other comics didn't show. And he was like, dude, as long as the show's good, they don't care. And I remember thinking, something's not right here.
Yeah.
Something's not right.
Yeah.
So once I got that Louisiana Lafayette, the Raging Cajuns, I'll never forget that school because of that reason.
Yeah. But you were probably just counting the money too, because you were getting, what, 100 schools? What
Easy. So I was doing like 4 or 5 a week.
Yeah, so you were just happy with the money, but you weren't realizing that you were getting ripped off at that time, huh? Yeah.
But here's the thing. Even if you're getting a lot of money, don't call me and say they don't have it.
Yeah.
When you're like, I'm getting this from other people.
Yeah.
You know? If I would have been getting the money I normally get, I wouldn't have probably even worried about it. But when you're telling me they don't have it, is what gets me. Like, hey, they only got this.
Mm-hmm.
Really?
Yeah.
Because another college called and offered me this, you know?
Well, why would you get into a business and burn the bridges, right? You know, here's the thing. The guy was ahead of his time. He was a genius. He really was. You got to call him for that, because he put together a college tour and he grabbed a hold of a bunch of up and coming black and, you know, us. But like, during a time when there were no comedy clubs booking black acts, you know what I mean? Like, you know what I mean? And if he would have maintained those relationships, he'd be huge right now.
He would have had a gold
mine. Because those guys are now, like, I remember catching the train. Just Michael Blackson alone. Like, how many times did he use Michael Blackson? I've opened for Michael Blackson so many times. When he used to wear the dashiki.
At the black college?
Sure, I used to open for him all the time. He had the dashiki. He dressed like an African guy. Before he was the Versace king.
So he dressed like his dad.
Before he was the Versace king, he was the Lion King. And then, or how about this one? JB Smooth. Like, who would have known JB would have been a household name at that time? You know what I mean? He had all those guys. And imagine if you maintained the relationship, man. Imagine if he would have maintained that relationship. He'd be fucking unstoppable right now. Mm-hmm. People would help him out.
I mean, he could have went from colleges to arenas.
He could have done arenas. Mm-hmm. But that's what you get for doing bad business. So fuck you, bro.
Whoa.
Fuck you.
Whoa.
No, he was a dick, man. He was a dick. He treated me like shit. I remember he never fed me on the road. So, you know, you do people bad and then, like me, fuck you, man. How about me? Like, I would have done something for you. You know what I mean? So
all you gotta do is apologize. That's what I did.
That's what you did.
Yeah.
But
I'm sorry about
just
that.
Just do good business. You know what I mean?
Bring coffee.
Don't be like Gary Owen.
One bad move. But you still forgave me because we went to Pony together.
Yeah, we did.
You brought me that pony relationship.
Yeah. It wasn't pony, bro.
Who was it? Puma? Who was it? It was pony.
It was Puma.
No, it was pony. You brought me to the guys that did like the pony. It was right downtown LA.
And that's Dada.
Dada. But then didn't they buy pony? Or it was Dada? It was probably Dada. Sorry about that.
What the fuck are you talking about?
I think it was pony, man.
Yeah, it couldn't have been Dada because Dada was before I moved to LA.
I brought you to this warehouse. And I was like, and they were like, yo, Joe's our guy. And then, because they gave me like a shirt and I had this pony shirt.
You're right, bro. It was pony.
I had these pony shoes. And I was like, what pony. Is that?
It was pony. You're right.
Man.
That's right. Yeah. I totally forgot. So it was after I moved to LA, right?
Yeah, you were here because you called. I was like, Gary, come down to this warehouse. My guys are here. And I hyped you up to them, said you're always on the road. Come get some gear.
You're right.
And I was like, all right. And I was like, thanks for the ponies. And then every time I wore them, people were like, where the fuck you get ponies?
Shit, that's not good.
I was like this. Nah. But I swear to God, I wore that. It was like a long sleeve t-shirt thing. I wore that to death.
Yeah.
Because just flying, you want to be comfortable.
Yeah.
Jesus, I was like this. Yeah, rock this black and white pony. Story of my life.
On that come up, though, you want that free shit, though, man.
To this day,
yeah.
I like free shit.
Yeah.
You'll spend all this money on clothes and watches.
Yeah.
But You get free shit, you take care of it.
Yeah,
it's like,
you take care of it. It's you weird. Iron it. You iron it.
There's nothing like getting the box and opening it.
Yes.
And you're like, oh.
Oh, this is nice. I deserve this. I deserve this. I'm getting
her. Now, what I wanted to ask you, I see you showing your jacket. Was it from the ghetto to the Getty?
Yeah.
What's that all about?
Ghetto to Getty. Okay, here's what I love about Ghetto to the Getty is my ex-wife and her boyfriend, he's an artist, ex-skater, Gino Perez, look him up. He's amazing, but he's an artist and he paints. I just broke up with my girlfriend at that time and I went over to her house. She lives right next to me. So she lives like six houses down and we're like best friends. You know what I mean? So I'll just walk over there. So I walked over there and he just got done painting that Ghetto to the Getty on this big giant, like a big art piece. And I see Ghetto to the Getty. He just painted it, right? And I'm just like, oh my God, that's fucking amazing, Gino. Like that's for two reasons. One, it just looked amazing. And then two, it was like indirectly telling me like, yo, that's my life, man. Like if you would have seen the stuff I did before I got to where I'm at now, like, you know, playing the Forum or whatever, or Chase.
Wow, that's, we'll just throw that in.
Yeah, Chase, Forum, Radio City Music Hall.
85 shows Mola in Hawaii.
Arena,
yeah.
Super Theater, Australia. Yeah. Who gives a shit?
That's fine.
Anyways, top 10 in arena acts in the world, whatever. Wow. Elton John won, I was said. Look, it's fine. Let's not talk about that.
Yeah. That's not why I brought you on.
Yeah. 60,000 tickets sold in a week.
I miss Black College Comedy. Buy your own food at Piccadilly, yeah. Jo Koy.
So I was just like, when I first started, my first gig that I, when I rented out these theaters in Vegas on Charleston and Maryland Parkway, which is not the best part of Vegas to be, and it was called the Huntridge Theater. I used to rent it out all the time and book my own shows to getting to the Forum. And I was just about to shoot my second special for Netflix, Coming in Hot. So right when I saw it, I was like, I have to wear this. Like, I want to wear this. Like, that's my story on the back.
So wait a minute. He's an artist. He was putting on jackets, or was he? Was
no,
it
no,
a painting?
He was painting it.
Yeah,
he
painting, right?
He just painted a big, giant canvas like this. Okay. And it said, Ghetto to the Getty. And I was just like, well, was it a big? Well, you know what I mean? He had a painting.
Yeah.
And he painted it. And right when I walked in, I was like, yo, I have to wear that on my back. Like, when I shoot this special, I'm wearing that on my back. Yeah, he gave it to me. He let me wear it. I love it, man.
But isn't it getting passed around? Like, I've seen other people like,
yeah,
have it on.
Man.
Is it the same
people,
jacket or are you reprinting?
That's mine.
It?
That's mine.
Because then I see Nate Burleson.
Yeah, Nate wore it. Dion got it. A lot of people got it. Tisha got it. A lot of people have it. I love that fucking jacket. I love the way he painted it.
They're all the same
it.
Size?
No. You think I'm handing one fucking jacket?
That's
Gary?
What I'm asking.
No, there's a ton of them. I got it. You want one? I'll give you one.
Yeah.
Is this your indirect way of saying, can I have one?
I'm just saying. I mean,
done.
I don't know.
I wish you would have told me.
60,000 tickets
it.
In a week. I mean, what's the ghetto to Getty?
Yeah.
59,995 tickets?
Yeah.
It's just five tickets sold. It's how much it costs.
I wish you would have told me. I would have brought it, man.
I honestly don't research my guests.
Yeah,
so
at
I'm winging,
all.
I'm winging
obviously.
It. I'm winging it. So it just popped in my head. There's a lot of dead moments in my podcast. I let other people research. I just go like this. So, Joe, where'd you get your glasses?
I love it. By the way, these will be on sale real soon. I'm just saying, these are mine. I made them.
Speaking of.
You're not even impressed by that?
No.
These are my frames.
What's
don't worry about the side. Don't read that
it
yet.
It says something else.
I know, but just wait. Just wait.
So this now you're going to have prototype. Your own
These
glasses?
Will be on sale in about 2 weeks. You can use them for blue light if you want, or you can get prescription.
Is there a website?
Yeah, jokoy.com.
Jokoy.com.
Get these glasses right here.
Get
You'll
these
be the
glasses.
First one. I'm selling everything. If I'm wearing it, I'm selling it.
Well, let's do a promo then, Joe. I got to do a commercial.
Let's go.
You shave your own head?
Yeah, I do.
Do you shave your balls?
I do shave.
You look like
shave. I don't
balls.
Shave the balls, but the top part of it, I give it a nice little fade, like a 1.5 to a 3.
Well, Joe, Manscaped.
Oh, I love it.
Has the Lawnmower 3.0 skin-safe technology. You won't cut your balls. I'm reading this.
Yeah, I know.
Also has a headlight.
Yeah.
So you can see when you're trimming.
Hold on, Gary. I'm going to interrupt you there.
Do it.
That headlight really works.
Does it?
I want everyone to know that. If you use this Manscaped, watch the difference between clippers and the ones with the headlight. That shit is amazing.
It's also waterproof. Did you know that?
I took a shower using it one time.
Did you?
For the sake of this commercial, I did.
Well, look at this. Well, if you go to manscaped.com, you get 20% off and free shipping using the code GETSOME.
What? Spell get some.
GETSOME.
I love it.
That happens to be the name of my podcast.
What?
Boom. They said if people buy it, they're going to pull up the Brinks truck for this podcast.
Oh, I'd love that.
Lou, let's do it one more time. Yeah. Hey, Joe, you shave your head?
No, I do not.
You don't shave your head.
But I shave my dick. Can you use this one?
Yeah.
Can you use this commercial?
Wow. You shave the cock. Wow. I was thinking the balls.
You know what I love about Manscaped? They don't mind these kind of commercials. They'll let you talk dirty or be clean. So
look,
they don't give a shit.
If you want to shave your cock and balls.
Yeah.
Or balls and cock.
Do you sometimes shave your balls and accidentally cut your cock? Well, use Manscaped because it has a headlight.
How about this? You ever outkick your coverage and you're like, God, my balls are hairy and this girl's going to see them. Let me run to the bathroom real quick, not turn on the light, put that little headlight on, trim it up, come back in, handle your business, baby. Nothing's going to get in your teeth.
That's brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
That's
20%
brilliant.
Off.
Yes.
If you go to manscaped.com, use the promo code GETSOME. It's funny how my podcast is perfect for Manscaped.
Yeah, this is perfect.
Get some. Manscaped, because you're manscaping because you want to get some.
Yeah. You just put that together now. You're genius.
Joe.
Get some.
I'm going to be at the Chase Center, brought to you by Manscaped.
It's going to be your logo back behind you. Just nothing. Clippers. It's going to be your name written in Clippers.
Every guy's coming in Speedos. We all use it, Gary. So, that's my promo.
I love it. I'll buy it.
Now, I think we talked about this earlier, but what year was it that you started to move tickets? And I think you said it was Phoenix, right? Was it Phoenix? No,
nope.
Phoenix was me. That's when I first realized I was moving some tickets.
Tampa.
Tampa, that's right.
Tampa Improv.
Yeah.
It was a Thursday night, and I noticed that the room was packed, but they used two-for-ones on top of the sales that I had, right? Mm-hmm. So I told the manager that night, after that show, I walked up to him. I can't remember his name, but you know Tampa Improv, the short guy.
Bob?
I think it's Bob.
Bob's been there for 20 years.
Oh, I love that dude.
Yeah.
So cool. Wears the same outfit.
Yeah, like, same belt.
Yeah,
same
you're just like, you're like,
hey, what's up?
Yeah, it's like, man, have you hit profit at all or no? What's going on? You're still working like you just
do me a favor.
Started the business.
If you do the Tampa River game, bring him a ghetto to the Getty jacket.
Yeah, I will.
Pants, belt.
Yeah, yeah. I remember walking into his office after that show and I go, no more two-for-ones. For the rest of the week. Don't even offer them. Don't hand them out. And he was like, are you sure? It's probably going to only be like half a room if you do that. Don't you want a packed room? And in my head, I'm like, I don't want a packed room with a bunch of people that don't know who I am or didn't invest to come see me.
Yeah.
Because then they're not going to appreciate the show. I'd rather have the people that paid to see me and I'll build my audience that way. And that shit worked out. It was the best gamble of my life, man. By the way, that was the first one I ever did a percentage deal, too.
And that was it 50-50?
That was, 50-50 was
the
first.
Isn't it crazy?
Yeah.
Because I remember when you first start, you get the set amount.
Yeah.
And then you get, like, bonuses.
Yeah.
You get, like, hey, if 300 people show up, you get $500, whether it's papered or not. And I would tell everybody, I would tell my road manager, my openers, all your comps are Saturday.
Yeah,
we're going to guarantee I'm getting $500.
Yeah, that's funny.
And let them lose.
Yeah,
my road manager got so out of control because he was so used to comps.
Yeah,
and then when I started selling tickets, I was like, no comps, dude. It's coming out of my pocket.
Yep.
My dad was the worst.
Yeah,
I'd come to Cincinnati. My dad'd be like, "This is what he'd say to me. Hey, man, I got the he was a FedEx driver.
Oh no.
So he'd be like this. Yo, I got this guy. I'm around. He's a big fan. I go. Big fans buy tickets, Dad.
Yeah.
He's a guy who wants some free shit.
Yeah.
Let's be honest.
Yeah.
I had to cut my dad off even.
I don't think they understand what that means when they say it. Because I hear that from my family all the time. Oh, God, the biggest fan.
No.
This is your biggest fan. No, this is actually my least favorite fan. Yeah. That's what this one is.
He does nothing for me.
Yeah, absolutely nothing.
I used to do if I had friends in a city and they'd be like, yo, Gary, my boy wants to come to the show. I said, all right, but he's got to buy a DVD afterwards.
Yeah.
Free tickets, but that motherfucker better buy some merch.
Yeah. You know what? Here's one I hate. This is oh, you're going to love this one. Is my mom will beg me for these comps, right? Joseph, biggest fans. Please let them come to your show and do the meet and greet, Joseph. Please. All right, Mom. You know, I'm already dreading it, right? So this is just the one story, all right? They come, huge fucking line, by the way. These are all paid people, right? Here comes my mom's comps, right? Boom, they get to me, and they're acting like they did me a fucking favor.
I hate that shit.
I'm like, what in the fuck kind of conversation is it? Do you think I'm an up-and-comer motherfucker? Do you not see how many fucking people came to see me? Like, I don't even know you. And then the guy was like, well, let's take a picture. Should we show your mom that we actually came? And I'm like, what? Who the fuck is this guy? Get the fuck out of here. That was the worst. That was one of the worst ones ever, man. And I was just like, that's when it had to, like, stop. It's like, Let me ask you this.
You leave a friend of a friend's tickets, and I'll give you an example. So Miguel, the singer, came to Cincy, and he left my wife and my daughter and her friend left three tickets for them.
Yeah.
So we're very appreciative of free shit. So we made sure we bought everything. We bought all his T-shirts, if he had coffee mugs, everything that was at the merch thing in the lobby, we bought. So afterwards, my wife goes to Miguel, he got backstage, and she goes, oh, hey, we got your hoodie. Miguel thought she said, can we have a hoodie?
Oh.
And she said, Gary, his face went, because in his brain, he thought, I left these motherfuckers free tickets and they want a hoodie?
Yeah.
And then she goes, yeah, no, we got the hoodie. We bought it. And showing all the shit, they said, Miguel did a 180. He goes, oh, shit, let's get pictures. And I go, it's those little things.
Yeah.
But isn't that the worst? You give people free shit. Then they want more shit backstage.
Here's another one I hate. You ready, Gary? That one's funny, too. This one's even funnier. You ready?
You're going to be bigger than Miguel.
You're going to love this one. Yeah, this one's going to beat that one. You get the text. Yo, man, I heard you're in town. Yes. Hey, man, do you mind if I get some tickets? Oh, yeah, for sure, man. I'll leave two, right? I never give tickets, but yeah, I'll leave two. Cool. What time is it? No. That's the story. That's the story.
Oh, my staff's thorough. We don't fuck around. Way to break the fucking pause. It was dramatic pause. That story is better because my staff is overzealous.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. Oh, wait. She said Owen.
That's the same one that brought you your coffee.
Ah, damn it. That's the worst is when they beg for tickets and now they want directions. They want to, what time should I be there?
Or how about this text, Joe?
When do doors open? No. Can I go back? I'm like, motherfucker, I didn't even want you here. Yeah. I actually came to the city not knowing you lived here, motherfucker.
How about this?
Yes.
How about they call you, Joe, and go like this? Hey, man, you know I got to support. No, support is buying tickets. You're not supporting me. And let me tell all those people out there, this is how you get free tickets. You always offer to pay.
Yes.
And you got to be prepared to pay if it doesn't happen. The offer will get you free shit.
Yes.
Always. I'll always be like, dude, I don't mind paying, but you know, you're in town. If you got any free ones, great, but I don't mind paying. We're coming regardless.
Yeah, cool. And that's from Gary. And me, I'm not giving any more comps. So don't even fucking ask me.
I can't get a comp?
No, I'm just talking to my, you can come. Fuck yeah, you can come. Just have to
I'm
do 10
come
minutes.
To a guest spot.
Just have to do 10 minutes.
No, you're going to fuck me. Joe's going to fuck me next time. Be like, hey, Gary, you're going after me?
Hilarious. When I say goodnight, go up and crush.
You know who did that to me? And I had to fucking pull myself up by the bootstraps? Judd Apatow.
Really?
He saw me. He came in Nashville and didn't saw. He was getting ready for Bonnaroo.
Uh-huh.
And he just did a guest set. And he didn't really know who I was.
Yeah.
And he went on Joe Rogan's podcast and talked about it. He was like, you know who Gary Owen is? And Joe Rogan's like, that's a white guy that does the black rooms. He goes, yeah. He goes, I went and saw him. He goes, I don't know if I should be in the same business as this guy. He goes, he was about to kill the audience. He had to stop because people were going to die. He goes, and then I had to look at his material. He goes, that's really good material. It's not like haggy. So then he did that thing at the Largo. He does those things. So I go there, and I think, I can't confirm, but I think they were testing me because it was not my audience after Adam Sandler.
Oh.
So Adam Sandler's, they go, you're going to go up after Adam. And I went, should I be before Adam? And they go, no, it's fine. So Adam does these fucking songs.
Yeah.
When they said Adam Sandler, the crowd went nuts.
Oh, nuts.
Judd goes up, now we got a guy, I saw him, he's pretty good. I had to get off the Adam ship for 10 minutes and then finally got him back.
Yeah.
wasn't like Nashville. Don't get it twisted.
Yeah.
But still, I was like this. I think that was a test.
A little payback?
No, I think Judd was like, let me see how this motherfucker does with this audience.
That's a great story, man.
That's like you, Gary. Joe, can I come to Chase Center? Yeah, you want to go up? Yeah. All right, I'm going to bring up right after I say goodnight. Oh, you know who did that?
Who?
Jamie Kennedy one time.
Did what?
We did a college. No lie. I love comics that just are brutally honest, right? The poster is Jamie Kennedy, and this is like 20 years ago when I was fucking people at the Comedy Store.
Yeah.
So
I was
I'm in the
that.
Corner, uh-huh. right? So if there was 2,000 kids in the audience, it was UC, like San Bernardino or something.
Yeah.
1,500 white kids there to see Jamie. I had the little black, 500 black kids there, right?
Yeah.
Jamie goes, right before the show starts, hey, Gary, man, look, man, I got like 20 minutes. You mind headlining? I go, huh? He goes, I got like 20 minutes right now, dude. I'm just getting back into this. He goes, you mind if headline? I'll bring you up. And I go, that's fine. I said, but you can't, you got to hype me up, dude. You got to get them ready. Be like, this is my guy. He's my favorite comic. I say, because I don't want to go up there and 1,500 white kids get up and walk out of the room.
Yeah.
To Jamie's credit, that motherfucker brought me up like I was Will Smith. He said, yo, this is my guy. He's my favorite. Don't leave. I'm not leaving. He was gone by the time I got up. He just hyped me up. I go, I can't be mad at him. Everybody stayed.
Yeah.
But he was so honest backstage. Yeah. I got like 20. You mind going up?
Yeah, headline? Jamie's always been cool like that.
Yeah.
I love Jamie, man.
You can't be mad at him. Like, I'll headline.
I love Jamie, man. He's always been nice. You know who, I've always told this story, who's just an absolute beast where I thought I'd crush it so hard there's no way he can follow me, is Cedric the Entertainer. I opened for him at the, it was an Indian casino here in LA somewhere, down by Ontario, that area. And I crushed so hard, Gary. And I'm like, oh, there ain't no way Sid can follow this shit. There's just no fucking way, man. And as I'm walking off stage, Cedric, he's on the side of the stage, like hopping back and forth like this. He's got a suit on with the matching hat. He's like, that's what I'm talking about, motherfucker. Make me work for this money, motherfucker. Let's go, Jo Koy. Smacks my hand. They go, Cedric, the Entertainer, walks out. I swear to God, maybe 30 seconds into that fucking act, no one remembered me. Not one fucking person.
He's a king of comedy for a reason.
Man, beyond king. Like, that was the day I was like, that's a headliner right there. Yeah. That's what you do. Doesn't matter who the fuck is in front of you, make them forget.
Well, he brings some of the funniest people to open for him this day. You know J.J. Williamson out of Mississippi?
Mm-mm.
I don't like working with J.J.
It's a beast,
He's that He's that funny, and it's just, he sucks. It's one thing to be funny, and you guys got to do a music bit or a dick pussy joke. Mm-hmm. I get it. We all got them. That's fine.
Yeah.
JJ just brings him into his world.
Nice.
He's got like a comic book joke.
That I got to look this up.
Dude.
I got to look him up.
And Cedric's been rocking with him for so many years, and I'm always going, dude, I always want to call Cedric, why are you doing that to yourself? That guy is a fucking monster.
Oh, that's great. But that said, though.
That's what I'm saying. That's just him. Even Malik S.
Mm-hmm.
Malik's a beast.
I love it, man.
But I'm always like, Cedric's bringing some funny. Who you got regular openers or you switch it up?
I switch it up, but I always like guys that, like, you know, that when I saw Ced do that, Dave's another one. When I opened for Dave, you know, just walked right up as if nothing
even
happened.
Dave East, the rapper?
Dave East, just in the southern part of the States. Crushed it, though. Which didn't make any sense since his name is East.
We got to talk about Chappelle's camp.
Amazing. Amazing. I can't wait for that to open up again.
Well, they're doing like that run in Austin right now at Stubbs.
Yeah. But I can't wait for it to go back to Yellow Springs.
Yeah. You enjoyed it.
I loved it.
Isn't that crazy? Did he try to get you to move there? To get me to move
there. I am moving there. So get ready. I'm going
to That's what he says to me. He goes, hey, Gary, where you staying at now? I said, well, I got a house in Northern California. I still got an apartment in Cincinnati. He was like, man, you got to just come to Yellow Springs, man.
Yeah.
I'm trying to get everybody to move here. But is the rumor true that he bought the firehouse and it could turn into a comedy club?
I think the rumor's true because I walked around with him for about 4 hours where he showed me everything he purchased.
Oh, the town is his.
Oh, man. You know what I love about Dave? I don't know if this is too personal, but just him scrolling through his photos on his iPhone. You don't want to scroll through mine, right?
Yeah.
His are just plans of buildings and just blueprints of what he's going to do to this one and what he's going to do that. It's pretty impressive, man. The dude is, I keep telling him this, but he's a godsend to that town, man. He's a
godsend to people.
Oh yeah. To people for sure.
Think about when he did the, I want to say Netflix, but it was a YouTube special.
Yeah.
Where he talked shit about Don Lemon and mm-hmm. all these other people. Yeah. And they were so happy their names came out of his mouth.
Yeah.
And if there was a bunch of people that he talked about that are normally sensitive.
Yeah.
They weren't offended. They yeah. weren't mad. I know people. I posted a picture of me and Dave at summer camp, right?
Yeah.
There's people in my family that are Republican, Trump supporting, and yeah. they went like, "You met Dave?"
Yeah.
You know, I was like this. He's the complete opposite of everything you stand for, but yeah. it doesn't matter.
Nah.
Not with Dave.
Nah, there's something special about that man. Not even there's something special. He's special, man. He's. I always say this, like when I text him, I'll be like, "Yo, you're the light. You're a light, man. Like you're shining, man." And it's just fun to be under that light with him, because, and that we're a part of that, this, you know, like, you know, I wish I was part of that Richard Pryor, Eddie Murphy time, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But this is something a lot more deeper than that. Like this guy can talk about as extreme as the tension is right now. Mm-hmm. He can go up there and make an amazing joke about it, but also make you think about it at the mm-hmm. same time. It's just,
but it's
beautiful. And to be honest, I'm sorry to interrupt you.
No, go ahead.
I think he's just talking. I don't even think he's writing at this point. I think mm-hmm. he's just fucking talking. And it's amazing. It's amazing to witness.
Well, you try to figure it out, right? You're like, what's going on here? And Trevor Noah just put it perfectly. Mm-hmm. He was doing an interview, and he said he was on a show with Dave at Radio City Music Hall. Mm-hmm. And he was looking at it like, why am I on this show? I don't need to be on the show. He doesn't need me on the show.
Yeah.
So he pulled Dave aside. He goes, why you got me on the show? Like, I'm not at this level yeah. after watching Dave work and stuff. Dave goes, nah, I know a lot of funny people. You're interesting. And that's what yeah, it is. It's so true. Like, yes. you've got funny, there's tons of funny people out there.
Yeah.
But you know the ones that are interesting. And you always wonder, why is he your favorite? And I'm like, because he's interesting. That's yeah. what it is.
That's so dope.
You know
I
what
love
I mean?
That guy. Yeah, that was, I'm telling you, man, that weekend was so special, man. Shout out to Tiffany. You know, Tiffany is the one that brought me out originally. She had the jet. We both flew out, you know what I mean? And, mm-hmm. and landed. Next thing you know, we're in that cornfield getting tested.
Yeah.
And next thing you know, I'm on stage in the middle of a cornfield. It was just like, during that pandemic, you know, you're dreaming about getting on stage. That was my first joke I said. I was like, you know, when this pandemic started, I was on this huge tour, blah, blah, blah. Everything was taken away. And all I could think about is, I can't wait to be on stage again in the middle of a cornfield. And this shit came true today. Thank yeah. you so much, Yellow Three. Thank you. It was just a dream. I was even telling myself that would never happen.
Yeah.
Dave made that happen. But it was amazing. Most amazing. Well,
when it happened, I remember they called. He was doing the first show, right?
Yeah.
And I'm with UTA. Who are you with?
I'm with CAA.
Okay. So yeah. Joe called me at UTA, and he was like, yo, Gary, where you at? I was like, I'm in California. He goes, ah. I go, what? He goes, Dave just called. And he's looking, he wanted to know if you want to be on the show tonight.
Oh,
but he's
dope.
In Yellow Springs because he thought I was in Cincinnati. And I go, what time's the show?
Yeah.
Dave's the only one you're like, let me see if I can get a flight.
Yeah,
and they go,
man.
Well, you're 3 hours behind and it starts in 3 hours. I go, there's no way I'll make it. I go, fuck.
so you didn't go that night?
I couldn't. Like, I got the call at yeah. like 2 p.m.
Damn.
LA time.
Yeah.
And so it's 5 p.m. in Ohio.
Yeah.
Show's at 8. I couldn't Shit. Have made it. I was like this. Yeah. And I literally was like, let me see if I can book a flight real quick.
Yeah.
I think he's like, there's about four people that make the call and you drop everything and go.
Yeah.
Let me ask you this. Chappelle yeah. calls, Joe, I had a fallout. I need you this weekend in Yellow Springs. You're at the Chase Center. You got two sold out shows.
Yeah.
What do you do?
Hey man, let me give you a Gary's number.
I just want to make sure your priorities in order. You don't drop everything all the time.
Not everything. Here. What? I got Joe, watches to buy.
Joe, I got the Filipino Doctors Association yeah, and yeah. Yellow Springs.
Yeah, yeah.
I need you.
Yeah, I already have that. Yeah. I already have that one already. Thank you.
I got the CEO at my show. Oh, you got the cubicle workers.
Yeah, yeah. That's what's up, man.
Who would you say outside, other than Dave, because he's clearly your favorite, by the way you talk.
Yeah.
After Dave, who would you say is your favorite that you enjoy watching?
Coming up?
As a kid, anybody, right now, like, just who do you like?
Okay, coming up, JB.
JB Smooth?
Before Curb. And you know what I'm talking about, man.
Jay was a monster. He's still a monster.
People don't understand. No, he's still a monster. But before Curb, before whatever, any of the movies, when it was JB.
In the cowboy boots?
Dude. Joseph, you got to see these, Joseph. Look at these shoes, Joseph. Oh, look at that, Joseph. This is beautiful. And it's fucking, you remember he put on those boots? He always got boots, right? He always got like some kind of fucking boot. And then for some reason, the pant leg would always get stuck at the top of the boot. Like he would never have it. You know what I'm talking about? There's just something like sexy, messy JB. You know what I mean? He's like, he got it together, but the goddamn pant leg is stuck on top of the boot. And it's JB, so you don't give a fuck. But man, I think that was everyone's favorite. Even if it was just a night at Ha Ha on a Tuesday and he found out that JB was going up. I mean, everyone, you remember the Ha Ha. It would just be complete chaos.
I used to live across the street from it.
Really?
I stole plates and forks because I didn't have afford any from the apartment. So I'd order dinner and then take the plate and fork to my apartment.
That's funny. What's the owner's name again?
I don't know.
Okay. 5 minutes. Okay, got 5 minutes.
11:20. My crowd is
this chicken your time, goddamn.
You said hard out 11:20, man.
We don't play. Okay. All right. Hey, man.
It's hit, but hey. You are Jo Koy. You can be late to your own shit. You know that, right?
No, I pushed it, by the way. I'll show you the text. I pushed it to 12:30. But I'm telling you, the Ha Ha was my favorite because remember the stage was right next to the lobby? And no one gave a fuck about anybody on stage. Mm-hmm. Like, the lobby was loud as fuck. Mm-hmm. You could hear it on stage. And it was always usually the comics in the lobby just talking and just drinking.
Yeah.
And then the minute JB, you know what I'm talking about. When JB was on stage, the comics would even
stop.
We would literally go out to watch him. And it could be the same act 3 or 4 times. Like, you know,
still funny.
It was just the way he did it. It was, man.
I was so mad.
One of my favorites ever.
I was so mad when I saw him have a hard time in Atlanta. Did you see that video?
Mm-mm.
Where he struggled at Phillips Arena?
No, I didn't.
I'm on those tours, man.
Yeah.
It's not brain surgery how this works.
Yeah.
It's whoever makes the most money goes last.
Yeah.
Whoever makes the least goes first. And you follow suit.
Yeah.
And sometimes you got those promoters you got those comics that get to the venue and they act like they got to do something. I'm always like, don't take headliner money if you're not ready to headline.
Yeah.
Don't do that to people. For those shows, like someone like JB, for that type of show, Atlanta, Phillips Arena, I'm sure was promoted to a heavy, heavy urban black, you know, I don't know if a lot of people have W-2s.
Yeah. Jesus Christ.
So I'm like, I remember seeing that lineup and I was like, why did JB go last on that show?
Ooh.
Not that show.
Yeah.
Because one, the crowd's going to be tired.
Yeah.
If you ain't got somebody keeping everybody on their time,
they're
going to be tired. And then JB's a storyteller.
Yeah.
So he's not, you could do the dick pussy, but he brings you it, like you said, he stories and you gotta sit there and be patient.
Yeah.
So when I saw him struggling in Atlanta, I was really bothered by the lineup and like, you gotta be smarter
than
that.
What you got there?
I wasn't there. I saw it, but I knew who the lineup was.
Oh, okay.
And I was like, he should have went. They did what I did to you.
Uh huh.
They did what I did to you.
Really?
21 years ago.
But what is it about those shows, and I'm not saying those for general reasons.
Black shows, urban shows.
Well, no, just those shows. What I'm trying to say is those overbooked shows.
Yeah.
Like there's a machine that's a proven fact that it'll work. It's just the most 3 guys, bro.
You can go 4 or 5 if everybody sticks to their time. That's the key. You gotta stick to your time.
You know what I do, Gary? I do 2.
Two-man show. That's what I do on the road.
I do too, bro. I do 15. There's a guy that gets 15 in front of me, and that's just so that they can get their goddamn drinks out of the way.
Yeah.
And I'm going 1.5, 2 hours. Like, I don't need 5 guys to get to me, bro.
You talking about at the arena or at?
Anywhere.
Oh, see, I do two-man shows at comedy clubs.
Yeah, two-man shows at the comedy clubs.
Yeah. My guy, whoever goes first, and then me.
But I don't think you need anything else, Gary. Like, if I do a theater, if I do an arena, I don't give a fuck. One guy in front of me.
Some of the promoters, they know what they're talking about. They're like, they're just like you said, it's proof. You got someone like yourself, you got Kev, you got Rock, you got Chappelle. Doesn't really matter who else is on the show. You guys are going to sell. Some of these, what do we call it, ensemble shows,
are to move tickets.
They're like, they make it an event. not so much the comedy show. It's all of a sudden it becomes the place to be. You know?
Oh, I got what you're
saying. So when you're doing stuff like that, it's like they put 5-6. And I'm just looking at like, JB shouldn't have went last on that. And I as a comic, we know JB's a beast. We know he's a monster.
Yeah.
And I hated how they're quick to put all that shit on YouTube and put all that shit out there of him doing bad, but you didn't put the 3 million shows where he destroyed up there.
Yeah.
Stop. I hate that shit.
I hate that shit.
Especially comics. Like, we know what the deal is.
Yeah.
I know that show probably was supposed to start at 8, probably started at 8:45.
Yeah.
Everyone didn't stick to their time. So now you're throwing GB to the wolves where 90% of the crowd's tired, for one.
Yeah.
And all you get is one person to boo, and then everybody piggybacks on it. That shit pisses me.
Well,
I can't
wait.
I'm going to have him on the podcast so I can ask him about that.
I love that guy.
Yeah.
He's always been a good dude. He's always been genuine from the day I met him all the way up until now. He's just an amazing dude. When I did my shows at the Hunt Ridge Theater in Vegas, he came and did my show for like $300.
Oh,
like,
really?
Yeah. What like, year was this that? Is like 1998. Mm. Like, so it was, 98, 99.
Did that college book him? Or?
Hilarious. No, he just did out of love, man.
Yeah.
He's just that guy. He's just that guy. When I did the Apollo, I remember, I think I did the Apollo in 99, right? And I knew he was in New York, and I called him because I told him I was going to do it. And he was like, hey, Joseph, I'm doing a show, Joseph. So I'm going to hit you. I'm going to set you up with my boy, Ian. And that's how I met Ian Edwards.
Wow.
And he literally sent Ian Edwards to come hang out with me. And then that's how I met Will. Like, this is all through JB, man. Mm-hmm. Like, he didn't have to do any of that shit, but he knew it was my first time in New York. And he was like, I just want to make sure you're okay, B. I was like, what the fuck? That's a dude, man.
There's a lot of guys like that out there, man. Comics get, sometimes we get bad raps, but I think we're a very giving community.
Oh, 100%.
When shit hits the fan.
Yeah.
Like, do you remember when Rudy Moreno went through his shit?
No.
He got real sick, and he had to do a GoFundMe. He didn't want to
I didn't know
house.
That. When was this?
About 4 or 5 years ago.
Oh, now and, I feel bad.
Well, I didn't mean to. But I just remember he did a GoFundMe, and I remember, I just never forget, I gave $500, and I was like, you know, because I remember him doing the Commerce Casino and looking out, and that $100 was a lot.
And
then you can sell DVDs.
Yeah.
Walk out with $200, like, I'm good for the week. I got
Damn,
money.
Damn, Gary.
So I remember I gave $500. Ken Jeong just fucking blew me out of the water.
Yeah.
Like, he gave 1,000. Like, literally, I clicked 500.
Aww.
And then I saw Ken Jeong 1,000, or back to back. I went, what the fuck was that?
It was a bidding war.
and then it gets worse. The better, really.
Yeah.
So I can't remember what the amount was. It was like 25,000, right?
Okay.
It got to like 23.
Yeah.
And then Ken just went, I'll give 3,000 more just to get him over the top.
That's
but I went,
beautiful.
Right, it's great.
Yeah.
Like, when Ken Jeong's message was the same one that I told you about, he goes, the dude put money in my pocket and I could get stage time when I couldn't. You know
Damn.
What I mean? So I think we are giving when it comes to shit.
Oh,
like
100%.
That.
And you just telling me that, I got to reach out to Rudy right now. Because he was beautiful. That Commerce Casino, man. God damn it, man.
He didn't even know how that saved me.
It
we
saved
had two kids
me
in
so
diapers.
Many times. And he always like, I'll give you the last spot. I forget how he talked, but I'll give you the last spot, man. Pays more money. Like, I'm there,
105.
Like 125. I'll be there. Sell as many DVDs you want. I'm there. I'm already here, Rudy. I've been here for a week now.
This is what I remember. The Comedy Casino, you do the show, you do 10, 15, and then you literally have to stand by the door, almost begging people to buy your DVDs at the time.
Yes.
But if you sold 10 DVDs, you walked there with $100, you're like, oh, come back. Okay, I got diaper money. I got food money for the week. I'm good.
Those are great memories, man.
Yeah, the struggle is the best part of this business.
100%. You know, they used to make fun of me out front of the Laugh Factory because I used to hand out my cards. After every show, I'd hand out thousands of cards. It said myspace.com/Jo Koy. And just hand them out, right? I just wanted to get Dane Cook numbers on my MySpace page. So I do it each show, after every show, shit, I'll hit 1 million in 10 years.
Yeah.
So I'm just handing out cards, right? And I swear to God, man, every night, like right when the show's done, all the comics would be like, Joe, you better run out there. They're going to get their cards. Where's your cards, Joe? They would make fun of me. I didn't give a fuck, bro. I'd run out there and hand those cards
out. What are their names?
Those are the
comics.
I ain't saying their names. But those are the memories, man. I love those days. I loved running out there and handing out those cards. I loved it, man.
I never doubted myself. Was there ever a time you doubted?
Not once. There was one time where I thought I should quit, but I didn't doubt myself. I for financial reasons, like maybe I should get a full-time job. It was right when my son was like one. I was like, fuck, man. I didn't have insurance. Mm. You know what I mean? If my son gets sick, I'm fucked. I remember him getting sick one time and I didn't have insurance for him. I was like, motherfucker, dude. So yeah, there was that time, but it made me work harder. It made me sell those DVDs harder. I remember in my head, I was like, I'm gonna sell these for $15 a pop. And I remember getting to the show and no one was buying. I was like, look, $5 a pop. Like, I need, let me just
get, how much you got?
Let me get $50. My son needs diapers, bro. So
Gabriel Iglesias, I remember he didn't even know I was struggling at the time, you know. And I saw him after a show at the Ontario Improv. And I showed up. They asked me to do a guest or something. Or no, I think it was one of those two show nights. One was Latino night, another one was mainstream or something.
Yeah.
So they was like, hey, Gary, $300, come out to Ontario Wednesday. All right. They go, got a Latino show afterwards. Gabriel Iglesias there. So I just never forget when I got there.
Yeah.
My show was over and I was cleaning out the green room, they started to bring like peanut butter and jelly and white bread. And I go, What the fuck's he doing? I go, it's a Gabriel's writer. I was like, what?
Yes. That's like, that's my guy.
Yes. And my friend. And then Gabriel showed up and he had this contraption and his guy was just burning CDs and DVDs. Yep. It had to be CDs. It was a CD burner.
Of the show. The show that night.
No, no.
No?
Just of a show. He had the original and they were burning it.
Wow.
And I go, what's that? He goes, it's a CD burner, dude. He goes, dude, you take it on the road with you. You burn CDs, you sell them after the show.
Yeah.
And I was like, where can I get it?
Fries.
And he was like, yeah, something like that.
Yep.
The next day, I went and got it.
Yep.
And Gabriel doesn't even know this story. I'm so far behind on my mortgage payment. We got two kids. I'm fucking I just paid the mortgage. We got absolutely no money in the bank. I got no money. I said, I was going to Tampa, improv. Yeah. I went to Tampa. Started burning those CDs, and I had nothing. So I bought that thing with like $150, another $50 for the CDs.
Yeah.
I'm burning them. And all the ones I'm burning,
yeah.
I was selling them for $15 at the time. The one would come out, bing, like 15, yep. 30. I'm counting the money, right? Yep. Probably sold 100 CDs that weekend. That's $1,500.
Yep.
I was like this.
Yeah.
Don't even know.
It was lights out, right?
Right? Mm-hmm. I mean, I used to pack that motherfucker in my bag and put sweats and shit around so it wouldn't break,
give
it
in the
box. Even though I had that mug for 3-4 years.
Yeah, that shit was... Did you buy the DVD burner or CD burner? The DVD?
No, it was CDs at the time.
Okay, I bought the DVD burner, and it came in stacks of three. I bought it from Fry's. You get three of them, and the 100 stack was $100.
Yeah, yeah. Right, it was similar. CDs was about the same price.
Yeah, and I was selling them for $5 a pop.
Jesus Christ.
And literally each stack. So if I had like four stacks, I'd be like, yo, that's $2,000 right there.
I know, right?
That's $2,000,
it's
right
crazy.
There. $5 a pop. That was a $400 investment, mm-hmm. $1,600 profit. Let's go.
But look how times have changed.
Yeah.
Back then it was cash only.
Yeah, cash only.
Now you got Cash App, Venmo, credit card, Square.
All of it.
If you
want to wave it on my machine, it takes it.
Oh, you're Filipino. You probably got some futuristic shit. How do you do your merch on the road when you got the big shows?
We have to hire.
You got a lot of merch.
Yeah. We have to hire. Well, my sister is amazing. So she the cool thing about having family is, you know, ain't nobody stealing it. You know what I mean?
Oh, sister, that's your family. Let's not talk about the bolo on my brother right now for stealing catalytic converters all over the city.
What?
Oh, he's a drug head. They got a video. Well, I got one brother passed. I don't want to bring the show down, but one brother passed of a heroin overdose. My other brother, who we all know is dealing, except for my mom and his dad, for some reason they're in denial.
Yeah.
They got a video. I'm on Facebook going, this girl, I got my fan page, but then I got my personal page. Yeah. Personal page is basically a high school reunion, right?
Yeah, yeah.
This girl sends me a video and said, is this your brother?
Oh.
And I went, I don't know. And it's two guys breaking into this garage. And the Ring cam got it.
Ugh.
And they're stealing this catalytic converter off his car. And I go, I don't know. It kind of looks like him, but I don't know. They're masked up. She goes, I'm not trying to make you feel guilty. She goes, but I shared this video, and everyone's saying that's Gary Owen's brother. We got different last names.
Yeah.
So I go, I don't know for sure. Next day, she's messaged me. There's a bolo. Be on the lookout for him and this other guy.
Stop.
It was him. They're doing it all over
stealing
the city.
Stealing catalytic converters?
Because you can get like $100 at the junkyard. And they can do it to buy their drugs. So they're, you know, if you can get 10 in a night.
Yeah.
boy's balling, but your sister's doing your merch.
Yeah. So. Yeah. My sister doesn't do drugs.
The good
Gary.
Thing about family, they don't disown you. Yeah. Oh, yeah,
yeah,
they do.
Oh, yeah, they do. No, my sister, she's amazing. So, but yeah, she's got that thing on lock. It's pretty amazing.
So it's like a family business, huh?
Yeah. Koy family like, business? That's what you got to do, man. Got to take care of the damn family, right?
Well, I'm saying. Yeah. Like this. Gary, how's your merch going? I'm bankrupt.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I bought 1,000 hoodies and I made a profit of $30.
Yeah, $35 is what I made this month.
Yeah. Actually, oh. So I asked this to all my guests. Studio comes to you, Jo Koy, your movie, bro.
Yeah.
Who you want to be your co-star? So you can pick anybody.
Well, I love Tiffany Haddish. I think she's amazing on screen. Mm. She's beautiful. She's funny.
Good babysitter.
Yeah, she's amazing. She's aside from being my friend, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like one of my best friends, but she's just like, come on, man. She's undeniable. She's a scene stealer. Mm-hmm. When she's, you know what I mean? And it doesn't matter who you put her up against. I there's just something special about Tiffany.
Yeah.
I love watching her. And she really is a student. Like she really does study.
Yeah.
Big time, and it shows. So that would be my tiff.
Oh wow, you're the first person. Guys usually say guys, obviously, but that's dope.
Yeah, Mike Epps.
Oh really?
I love Mike.
Yeah, I've worked with him.
If you can,
I've done movies with him.
Yeah. if you don't, there's something natural about Mike, man.
It's just, the same thing with the stage. Natural. You watch him. I've been on the road with him for like 4 years, mm-hmm. but.
I opened for him 3 times, and it was like the best 3 times of my life. It was like 20 years ago.
Did you get a contact tie?
Huh?
Did you get a contact tie?
Yeah. For the handshake. I love Mike, man. Always
Mike's
been nice.
Great.
I forget his manager. I don't know if it's the same manager. TC?
Yeah.
Is he still with us?
Yeah, TC ain't going nowhere.
I love TC, man.
He's in the same old school crew.
Yeah.
Niles.
Yeah. I love, there's something special about Mike.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mike's dope. Huh. I text Will, after Girls Trip came out, right? And I told Tiff this. I had her on the podcast, and I said, when I saw the lineup, Jada Pinkett Smith, Queen Latifah, Regina, I was like this. All Tiff's going to be like, I wasn't think like a man.
Yeah.
It's ensemble, but I had the least lines in that first one, right?
Boy,
and then when I saw it, I go, oh, wait a minute.
Oh, this is Tiffany's movie.
Oh, right. I was starting to think that. Like, what's going on here? And then I literally said, I don't think I've ever been as happy for somebody. Because we all knew her struggle. I didn't know she was homeless.
Yeah.
But I remember her calling me and saying she opened for me a couple times. And whoever her manager was at the time, she goes, hey, Tiffy, we're like working with you. I think that'd be a good fit, you and her. I said, I'm good, dude. I said, you guys do the work. Here's my schedule. Call the clubs. If they call me, I'm going to say yes. And then Tiff called, and we're on the phone, and she's telling me about her crazy ex.
Oh,
and I go,
man.
Tiff, this ain't going to work out. I said, I can't have you on the road, and he's coming after me.
Yeah.
And I go, and I'm telling him, if he's jealous now, I mean, you're going to be working with guys 90% of the time.
Yeah, that dude was weird, man.
I never met him. I'm glad I didn't.
Fucking scary, dude.
Right, but I was.
Well, we should
was
really so, talk about that.
But I was happy that she got that break.
Yeah.
In Girls Trip, man, and she just fucking took it and ran with it.
Oh yeah.
Jesus.
And now
Christ.
She's untouchable. She's amazing.
Yeah.
I love her. Good. Yeah.
The She Ready series.
Unbelievable. They Ready just came out.
They Ready. I'm sorry. I said She Ready. Sorry about that.
Yeah. She Ready. They Ready.
Everybody's ready.
But she's really ready. I love her. Speaking of the movie deal, I do have one.
Really?
Yeah. So it's with Steven Spielberg and Dan Lin.
Steven Spielberg. Hold on.
He used to be a maintenance guy over at
Did he do this? You did that movie with Drew Barrymore?
Well, you're talking about the Drew Barrymore movie. Is that what you're talking about? No, but I got this deal with Steven, man. It's pretty, it's amazing. And we shoot May 12th in Vancouver.
What's it about?
It's called Easter Sunday. It's movie just it takes place on that day. It's my family. It's chaos that ensues that day. And
is it was it your baby, so to speak?
This is mine. Yeah, it was actually initially I pitched it to Dan Lin. Dan Lin created It 1, It 2, Aladdin with Will Smith, all the Lego movies. Mm-hmm. He's amazing. Ride Back, and I love you, Dan. When Coming in Hot came out, my second special, mm-hmm. Steven saw it and brought me in for a meeting. And when I went in, they just asked me what movie, all of them, Holly, Jeb, I love you guys. When I went in and they go, do you have a movie? Because Steven wants to do something with you. And I pitched that movie in the room and they bought it in the room.
Wow.
It's crazy because it was like literally go in, pitch, and then they bought it that day. Like they called me at like 3 p.m.
Yeah.
I said, yeah, we're taking it. We're moving forward. Let's get you a writer. Let's get you blow up. Now we just picked out the director and they already have the dates locked in Vancouver, May 12th. We also shoot in Daly City, so we're going to shoot for like two
months.
Where's
Daly City?
San Francisco.
Oh, okay. I should know that because I live in Northern California.
Yeah.
I should have known that.
Yeah, you should.
I thought there was another Daly City in Canada.
Yeah. You're thinking of the Daily Planet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You so asshole. Steven is producing it.
Yeah, Amblin. It's going to be Amblin.
Oh, that's dope.
Oh, it's crazy, man.
You got
it's
your so cast cool. set yet? Or are you still
No, we're casting.
Is it a Filipino?
It's going to be everything, man. Everybody's in it.
Like oh, okay.
Yeah. So right. I want Tiffany in this goddamn thing.
I'm sure she'll do it.
And Gary.
Will you? I'm not. I didn't bring you off
Hey, remember what happened 20 years ago? You remember that day?
Hold on.
Hey, you remember George Wilbur?
You bring me in. We got a nude scene. Full frontal, Gary. Like this. And all of a sudden I get on set, it's cold.
You know what? I'm going to bring you in, and just before your scene, I'm going to bring in George Wilbur.
Or how about this?
Yeah.
How about this? You send me an 8-page monologue and cut it from the movie.
I make you shoot it anyways.
Okay, I got it.
Get into character, Gary.
Is it? I'm an extra when it comes out. But I honestly wish more movies just like what's cool about Coming to America 2.
Yeah.
They got comic heavy.
Yeah, man. Shit.
That's why I'm so excited to see it. We're like, I wish we had more movies where it was just a bunch of comics.
Yeah, man. Because
they always end up being classics.
Yes, man. Friday was amazing.
Yeah.
Coming to America is amazing.
Harlem Nights.
Oh.
Jesus Christ,
man. We can go on, man.
When you put a bunch of comics together and the energy's right, that's when magic happens,
it's done. It's a wrap.
You don't even need a script.
Just, yep.
Okay, what are we doing? You're going to walk into the gas station and be upset.
Exactly. Done.
Yeah. Your script's like that long. Yeah. Joe, what's the movie called? Fuck it.
Yeah.
That's how you pitch it to Spielberg?
Yeah.
What do you get? You got this idea. Yeah, me, and we'll just see what happens.
Yeah. Let's just run with this one.
Yeah.
That's just so keep the dope, cameras man. Going. Thank
That's
you.
That's so dope. I know Tiffy's going to say yes.
Yeah.
It's going to be dope, man.
She did already. She's sweet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And now,
I'm going public to really emphasize that she said yes.
Yeah, Tiff. And the soundtrack by Common.
No, I love Tiff. I hope she says yes. We talk all the time, so it's, right. You know, I just got to make sure it's right and and it makes her look good.
Well, we have a dinner bet. On the Super Bowl Sunday.
Yeah, Tom
Brady. I got Kansas City.
Yes.
That's funny. You said I got Tom Brady.
I got Tampa
Bay.
I got Tom Brady.
I got Kansas City.
Can we get tickets to this game or is it impossible to get tickets to this game?
There's people going. I mean, Will Packer's going.
Yeah, but how do you have to do special
I don't know.
Quarantine? Like, what are they doing?
I don't know.
Fuck, dude.
Got me.
This is that one.
Will bought a suite. He went in with Gary Sheffield and got a suite.
Really?
So they're good.
Damn.
I said, well, what a year to get a suite. With the Buccaneers.
Yeah.
Brady comes there.
God, he got it with Gary Sheffield. He played with the Rays.
For a little bit. He's from Tampa.
Oh, okay.
Tampa's got a nice little baseball pipeline. Dwight Gooden.
Yeah.
Well, then, but he's just a Tampa guy, and Sheffield's a Tampa guy.
Yeah.
Because Sheffield really got big with, like, the Padres and the Yankees. That's when he went through the roof. All right, Joe, I know you got your podcast to go to.
No, this was fun. Thank you so much,
Yeah,
Gary.
I'm glad you came on, man.
I love you, man.
Are you
really
on Cameo?
No.
Dude, I gotta sign you up. They said I'd get some extra money if I sign you up.
I can't
just
do
make, it. No, make your price outrageous and nobody will do it.
Nah,
$10,000 for a shout out from Jo Koy.
I can't do it.
All right.
Why? What is that? What you are you doing Cameo?
I love it. It's so easy. And the one guy from The Office makes over $1 million a year.
Stop it. Cameo. Which one?
The heavyset, Brian Baumgartner or something like that.
Oh, really?
Heavyset dude. Yeah, they do like the top grossing cameos.
Yeah.
I just did a film with David Koechner.
Uh-huh.
Yo, every day in between takes, he's doing, I was, what are you doing? He goes, Cameo. He goes, he's killing. He goes, he told me the money he's making. I want to put his business on there. But I was like, what the fuck?
Wow.
You know?
That's amazing.
Sign up. You set your price.
No, I'm good.
Hey, all right. I always say it's never enough.
But if you are on Cameo, my guy Gary Owen is there.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Appreciate it, Joe. I think you should do it. Anyways.
You know what? You should have him. This is what I want Gary to do. If you have a birthday, call Gary. Tell him it's your birthday. and then he's going to bring someone else's birthday to your birthday. Because that's what Gary does. He shits on your day. That's what he did to me 21 years ago.
After I had your podcast, I replayed that day in my brain. Because you know when you get done with somebody's podcast, you start like doing this. And I go, I didn't do it out of spite or evil or anything. I just got excited. Like, oh, okay, yeah, George, do 5 minutes. Kill it and I'll bring you up.
You did not, Gary. Stop it. You're trying to make yourself feel good about it. You know what you did that night. You know what you did. You were hugging. You were high-fiving. You guys were laughing. You know when someone's about to do something fucked up when they both laugh at each other and then they both look at this?
I did not do it.
You
so
guys
you
both
would bomb.
Were laughing and then you both looked at me like this.
Well,
you apologize.
I apologize. I am so sorry. Because I
are
say,
the greatest, those are
I
the best
was
stories.
The guy.
I love those stories.
It's funny now.
Yeah. It sucked.
How was
then.
That car ride back to Vegas?
It was long.
What kind of car was you in?
A Honda Prelude with a broken taillight. The kind you could reach in and grab shit out. You know what I mean? There was an actual hole in my taillight.
That's a smooth ride. Though.
It
Prelude ride
was
smooth.
Nice.
I don't give a fuck
the
what
SI,
nobody says.
Where the lights flip up.
I had my roommate in the Navy. He had a Honda Prelude. I go, man, I should love riding in that car.
Oh, it was beautiful.
Smooth.
Yeah.
So, it wasn't that bit of a
imagine
ride.
Driving it depressed.
Yeah.
Yeah. I love you, Gary.
I'm sorry, Joe. I am sorry. Can we get another coffee? Can we get another ice to make up
you're
for
so
it?
Dumb.
The next time you come, I have 21 coffee. 22 will be 22 years by then. God damn it. I feel bad. I do feel bad about that.
No,
day.
You don't.
I do.
I love you.
I love you too, but I feel bad. I'm sorry.
We all have stories like that. You want me to end it on one more bad story?
Yeah, that's fine.
So Robin Williams was going up all over town because he was just working out a set for the Oscars, right? So I'm at the Laugh Factory, and here comes Robin Williams. He walks in. I'm emceeing, right? Unbelievable, right? Like, I'm about to bring up Robin Williams, and then here comes Bob Saget, right? And Bob Saget's like, hey, man, I'm going to bring up Robin. I'm like, Bob. Come on, man. Like, let me bring up Robin,
right,
bro.
Right, no shit.
Like, come on. He's like, no, we got this thing. I was like, motherfucker, all right. So he goes and brings up, so he walks up, he does this surprise thing. Hey, guys, what are you doing? Well, I'm going to bring up a good friend of mine, ladies and gentlemen, Robin Williams. The crowd goes crazy. And I'm just like, fuck, that was my fucking asshole. Like, I was so mad, right? The cool thing about Robin is when he was walking off stage, because I had to close the show, as he was walking off, I go, dude, I really wanted to bring you up. Robin, he was like, oh, come back up. Let's go. Bring me back up. So I went back on stage and I brought him back up. So that was kind of cool.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, it was really cool. So we got to, improv a little bit on stage. But anyways, fast forward to 20 years later, it's me and Bob on like some interview together. And I called him out on that. And he felt so fucking bad. He's like, oh, I'm so sorry. I don't know what the fuck I was. I'm so sorry, Joe. I know what that meant to you.
One thing about Joe.
And then
Koy,
he started texting
shit.
Me.
Yeah. Joe, don't forget shit.
I don't forget shit. So Black college comedy tour. All right. Remember what you did.
1250. That's how much my Getty to the ghetto jacket is.
I love you, man.
All right. Love you too. Thanks for coming on, Joe.
I love you, man.
Love you too. Stop. Right. Now it's getting weird.
Get some.